Welcome to Entry Point Virtual Church. We are so glad that you've joined us today. In today's service, we are asking the question, what are you waiting for?
Good times for a change. See the luck I've had. Could make a good man turn bad. So for once in my life, let me get what I want. Lord knows it would be the first time.
The other day I heard myself say something that has since almost haunted me. I was talking to someone while waiting for an appointment and I said, I have some time to kill. Knowing, though I do, that time is our most precious gift, I heard myself say that I needed to kill some of it. It stopped me in my tracks. The concept of time is much more complicated and magical than we give it credit for. So what is it about this amazing stuff called time that so many human beings spend their lives wishing it would pass more quickly and then wishing they could go back and live it again? Why do I procrastinate and put things off until later only to find out later that I wish I would have done them sooner? During this pandemic, We can't do things the way we used to do them. But that doesn't mean that moments that make up our lives are any less precious. Just because we need to do things differently doesn't mean that we don't get to do things. Hours spent in quarantine are just as valuable as any hours we imagine living. God, we ask for your help with this confusing dilemma. And by help, I mean this. Help us to simplify that which we call reality. Make us patient and aware, and give us the power to grasp the simple understanding that this is the moment to live. Help us rise above our fears about being ready or good enough. And let us embrace every moment as one that deserves to be lived to its fullest, even if we have other plans later. Amen.
What are you waiting for? A test result? A letter? An email? A text? Maybe it's a new job. Maybe it's a new person, or a new chance, or a do-over. Most of us are waiting for life to go back to something like we used to have, something we used to call normal. Many of us are waiting for a vaccine. Right now, I think we're all like little kids, and we are all waiting for Christmas. We are currently in the season that the Christian church calls Advent. It is a season of waiting, of expectation, of hope, in preparation for the arrival of Jesus. Common activities during this time involve keeping an Advent calendar, lighting an Advent wreath, or hanging special ornaments on a Christmas tree called chrismons. Now, I don't need to tell you that we are not a traditional church, and so therefore we do not engage in those kinds of traditional activities. However, I do want to do what I often do, and that is to pull some of the wisdom and application from this traditional Christian church season and pull that into our 2020 lives. What are you waiting for? Or I could ask the question, what are you waiting on? Is there a difference between waiting for something or waiting on something? I think there is a bit of a difference. What are you waiting on implies that it is something outside of your control. What are you waiting on? The vaccines to be distributed, the Christmas experience to come. We have no control over those things. What are you waiting for implies that there is a bit of control over the situation, I think. I'm waiting for the right time. I'm waiting later to do this thing I need to do or I want to do because the time is not right to do it. Not right now. I need to wait for this condition to be met or for this thing to happen first. And I think we're all waiting on certain things, and we are all waiting for certain things. I'm going to make a bold statement. Waiting on certain things is much less costly than waiting for certain things to occur. Because if we are waiting for certain conditions and timing and for the moon to be in the seventh house while Jupiter aligns so that we can move forward, so that we can do the next thing that we need to do, then maybe we are wasting our own time. I happen to believe that time is valuable. And while we are waiting for something to occur, we might be the reason it's not occurring. I was recently moved by a blog written by Lori Deschenem, who is the founder of a very profitable company called Tiny Buddha. Here is some of what Lori wrote. Most of us are really good at finding reasons to wait. We wait to call good friends we miss because we assume we'll have plenty of time. We wait to tell people how we really feel because we hope it will someday feel safer. We wait to forgive the people who've hurt us because we believe that they should reach out first. We wait to apologize for the things that we've done because we feel too stubborn or ashamed to admit it. If we're not careful, we can spend our whole lives making excuses, holding off until a better time, only to realize that that time never came. Now, here's a radical thought. We can say those things right now. It might be terrifying. It might require humility. It might seem like it's not a priority, but this is our chance to live and love. This moment is our only guaranteed opportunity to be thoughtful, compassionate, understanding, forgiving, and kind to the people that we value. Powerful words, Lori. Now more than ever, we need to use the time that we have instead of waiting on or for something. We need to use the time we have to live. Sadly, we have been reminded more than ever since March 2020 that our days on this earth are numbered. Time is a gift. Many years ago, I watched a play that is from the genre of theater of the absurd, written by an Irish playwright named Samuel Beckett. The play was called Waiting for Godot, and this play is always described as a play in which absolutely nothing happens. In fact, because the second act is simply a reprise of the first act, it is a play in which nothing happens twice. Now, in the play, there are two characters who are engaging in a variety of discussions and sort of nonsensical conversations, talking in circles about all kinds of things while they are awaiting someone named Godot who never arrives. Absolutely no progress is made in the plot. They walk back and forth between a tree and then sitting down on the ground, and no progress is made. They do nothing. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want to live like that. It was bad enough that I wasted an hour and a half of my life watching them do absolutely nothing. I don't want to wait on something that doesn't happen. I don't want to waste my days or my time or my life. And I don't think you do either. So, here we are, waiting in the middle of a pandemic. Truth be told, every single one of us is waiting for things to get better. We are all stressed. We are COVID weary, and we all want life to be better. We want it to be less stressful, less frightening, and somewhat more normal. I know that many people are bored right now. They've run out of rooms to clean and projects to do around their house. They've binged all the really good Netflix series. I want to encourage all of us to realize that this gift of time that we have been granted with the people who share our home may not last forever. So, in this traditional Advent season, this time of waiting, this time of preparation for the birth of Jesus, we have to ask ourselves, on what do we wait? What should we do while we are waiting? What is the expectation of this birth? Lewis B. Smeads writes, "Waiting is the hardest work of hope." For me, the birth of this baby brings hope. It means spiritual renewal. It is God giving the gift of love to all of humanity. As we sit right now in one of the deepest moments of darkness we have ever experienced worldwide, it is comforting to remember that God is a light that shines in the darkness, a light that the darkness has never overtaken. I also want to admit that there is a personal darkness that can occur as well as this corporate darkness that we all share. We have all experienced frightening, stalled out moments of time in which we must wait, fearing what must come. May we rely on the presence of God to strengthen and encourage us in those moments. May we recognize that God waits with us. So as we wait, globally, locally, privately, let's be aware of the hope and the strength and the love that God sends us. And just like a tiny little baby in a manger, these gifts are sent to us often in the least likely forms. May God be real to each one of us as we wait. Amen.
Sitting in the urgent care waiting room, I fought back nausea and thoughts of 50 worst-case scenarios. The pain in my lower back thrummed with my breath, ebbing and flowing like waves. The gray-haired man entered the room and scanned the empty chairs, then me. Our eyes met and I looked away quickly, barely catching his warm smile. He headed to the window, picked up the stack of forms, and exchanged the usual pleasantries with the receptionist. He sat across from me with his clipboard and pen and papers, and I watched as he pulled out his wallet and fumbled for insurance cards and identification. "Such a pain," I said, "all those forms." I don't know why I said this. I mean, the forms were a pain, but I was never the kind of person who talked to strangers in waiting rooms. But here I was, striking up a conversation with some man I'd never met before. "Part of modern life," he said, his brown eyes bright and warm. "It's ridiculous," I said, words tumbling out of me. "And these insurance companies. Mine sent me to one clinic already today, and then that clinic turned out not to be part of my network, so then they told me I had to come here instead. I must have driven 20 miles out of my way today. Wasted day." His pen stopped moving across the paperwork, and he studied my face like I had his insurance policy etched there. Normally, if someone stared at me, I got uncomfortable fast and tried to break the contact. But this man was so, I don't know, caring and kind that I just looked right back at him and let him see the fear and sadness lurking under my impatience. "Don't be scared," he said. "Part of modern life is also good modern medicine. They have good doctors here." Tears flared in my nose before springing to my eyes in a rush of emotion, so strong I forgot to breathe. As though reading my mind, he said, "It's not the cancer coming back. The pain is a kidney infection. That's all." Even as I blinked in surprise that a stranger would say this to me, I felt relief flood through my body. "How do you know?" I said. It came out in a low whisper. "Are you? Don't you know?" The door to the examination area opened, and a nurse with a short black ponytail and pale blue scrubs called my name. "God?" I said. "An angel?" He just smiled and went back to his paperwork, like nothing happened. When I came out of the examination, kidney infection confirmed and prescription for antibiotics in hand, he was gone. I tapped on the intake window glass, and the receptionist looked at me through thick-framed glasses. "The older man who was here before. Did he leave?" "Older man?" She scrunched her nose. No one else has been in for the past hour or so. Just you.
Tune in next Sunday for our virtual service where we will investigate what it means to participate in the gift of forgiveness.